loves us if we have trouble or calamity, etc., etc., etc. I don't know about you, but when trouble comes, sometimes we tend to think, did he stop loving us? Or what did I do to deserve this? Or why is this happening to me? Or etc., whatever the question may be. He has not stopped loving you. He has not stopped loving you. And I'm going to give you some reminders today from the Word of God to show you a season that some of us don't like. But there's a time and a place for everything. There's a time and a season for everything. What does it say in Ecclesiastes? A time to weep and a time to go to Ecclesiastes 3. I wasn't going to go here, but I got some other passages I'll go to in a little bit. But look at Ecclesiastes 3:1. To everything there's a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, to die, to plant, to pluck up those plants, to kill, to heal, to break down, to build up, to weep, to laugh, to mourn, dance, cast stones away, gather stones, embrace, a time to refrain from embracing. Time to gain, to lose, to keep, to throw away, time to tear, time to sow, to silence, to speak, to love, to hate, to war, and peace. What profit has the worker from that in which he labors? There's a time for everything. There's a season for everything. I like the season when I was a young man and I graduated from college and launching out alone and getting away from mama and papa. Then there was a season I went through before I met my wife Pam, and I didn't like that season so much. Then there was a season when I met my wife, Pam. It wasn't my wife at the time, but she was going to be my wife. I didn't know it, but God knew. Then there was a season of Matthew coming along, and then Andrew coming along, and everything goes with child raising. Those seasons were great. Seasons when my friends were becoming, they were getting married, and seasons when they were having families. And then there came the season as we started aging that we see people we love die. I don't like that season. Where dads die, moms die, aunts and uncles and cousins die, and even children die. And then there's a season when we lose one of our spouse. There's a season in our life when we're very healthy and very virile and everything's going well. This is great. Then there's a season in our life where the hospital see more of us than we see of anywhere else. I don't know about you, but I've got a lot of sick calls in 30-some years of ministry, and they don't get any easier. But one of these days there'll be a sick call for me, and people will come to see me, and there will be no more. Can anything separate us from Christ's love? And when we start going through things, does it mean he no longer loves us? How ridiculous. How ridiculous to even think that. But sometimes we tend to think that, and I don't mean to belittle that. I don't mean to put that down. It's very easy to think that. I want you to turn to Isaiah 46. And I want you to listen closely, especially verse 4. Isaiah 46. Isaiah 46. And part of what caused me to put these thoughts together this week was pain in my own body. Pain in some of the members of the congregation, in my own son. And in one of my devotionals I was studying this week. In Isaiah 46, start verse 3. Listen to me, O house of Jacob. Listen to me, Ralph and River of Life. And all the remnant of the house of River of Life, who have been upheld by me from birth, who have been carried from the womb, even to your old age. Listen now. This is for you. Even to your old age, I am he. Even to the gray hairs, I will carry you. I have made you. I will bear you. Even I will carry and will deliver you. To whom will you liken me to make me equal and compare me that we should be alike? lavish gold out of the bag and weighs silver in the balance. They hire a goldsmith, and he makes it a god, small g. They prostrate themselves as they, yes, they worship. They bear on the shoulder, they carry it. I don't know about you, but I don't want a god that I can carry on my shoulder. I want a god to carry me on his shoulder. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
They bear it on his shoulder, and they carry it to the center of the place that stands. From its place it shall not move. I don't want a god that's stationary in one place. I want a god that's ever present. I want a god that's always with us. I want a god that's been there before I even got there. I want a god that was there in the past. He's in the present. He's in the future. I want a god that can do it all and been there and done it all. Can I hear an amen? I've seen these kind of gods, this kind of statuary, and I was raised up in statuary like this. And I'll tell you what, none of those statues ever did a thing for me. I don't care how pretty they're painted, how many candles you light to it, how well they're decorated, ain't none of those statues that ever did a thing for me. Can I hear an amen? They set up a place of standing, for its place it shall not move, because it's not living. Though one cries out to it yet, it cannot answer, nor save him out of his trouble. Remember this, and show yourselves, men. Recall to mind, you transgressors. Remember the former things of old. How many times have you heard me say, get a resume together of all the things God has done for you. And when the devil starts attacking you, he says, God don't hear you, and God don't love you, and God don't care for you. That's why you're going through this. You pull out the resume of all the answers and prayers that God had for you. Yeah. You say, listen, devil, I'll tell you how much God loves me. Remember when he delivered me here. Remember when he delivered me there. Remember when he did here in the past. And if he did it in the past, he'll do it now. And if he did it now, he'll do it in the future. Can I hear an amen? That's the kind of God I serve.
Amen.
For I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning. He already knows the end game. He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He knows the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure, calling a bird of prey from the east, and the man who executes my counsel far from a far country. Indeed, I've spoken it. I will bring it to pass. River of life, I've spoken it. I will bring it to pass. I've purposed it. I will also do it. We need to hang in there. He's spoken it. He'll bring it to pass. He's purposed it. He will do it. Listen to me, you stubborn hearted who are far from righteousness. I will bring my righteousness near. It shall not be far off. My salvation shall not linger. And I will place my salvation in Zion, in River of Life, for the glory of my church, River of Life. I've changed a few words around to make it more pertinent to us. But this is the verse I really want to key on. For even in your old age, I am even, even to your old age, I am he. And even to your gray hairs, I will carry you. I have made and I will bear, even I will carry and deliver you. A couple other verses in scripture before I get to the body of what I want to talk about. Go to Psalms. You know the Word of God is so wonderful. I don't know how I lived all those years without the Word of God. I don't want to live without the Word of God. And the one thing I've loved so much since I've been saved and studying the Word of God, the devil has attacked my eyes with floaters, and it's very difficult to study the printed pages. But I thank God for my phone. And I thank God I have an application on my phone called the YouVersion of the Bible. I can turn that background black like this, and I can study the Bible. And if for some reason I still can't study, I can't study that way, I can turn on this. Maybe it'll work out a little. That's not what I'm looking at. Okay. But what you can do is you can put on audio and you can listen to it. You know, brothers and sisters, there's so many ways we can study the Bible today. So many ways. And the devil tries to attack us when we stay out of the Word and so forth. What you have to do is become creative. You have to be like a Marine. You have to learn to adapt, to improvise, to overcome. When he attacks you one way, don't just give up. Well, I tried. Try a little harder. Be like a little train that could. I think I can. I think I can. If you don't know that, if at first you don't succeed, try again. But today it is, if at first you don't succeed, forget it. I'm done.
Yeah.
Where would America be if it were like that today?
Yes.
I know where America's going to be tomorrow if we don't get our head out of our proverbial south end. If we don't wake up and smell a coffee, there ain't going to be no coffee to smell. We got to teach our kids, adapt, improvise, overcome. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And that's the problem. People don't know who Jesus Christ is, and they don't know they can all do all things through Jesus Christ who strengthens them. If you don't know Him, you can't do it. Now, this is my notes, by the way. In Psalms 39, I want to talk about, Lord, verse 4, make me know my end. And what is the measure of my days, that I may know how frail I am? Indeed, you have made my days as a handbreadth. My age is nothing before you. Certainly, every man at his best state is but vapor. Surely, every man walks about like a shadow. Surely, they busy themselves in vain and heaps up riches and does not know who will gather them. Our days are very short. Our time is very limited. Lord, teach us to know the number of our days. Now turn to Psalms 90, verse 12. And it says here in Psalms 90, verse 12, so teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. And if you're wondering where I got that terror by night, arrows of flight by day, look at the next chapter, 91, verse 5. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night when the arrows of flight by day. We're talking about that one at sunset. So there it is. So, no, I wasn't making that up. And lastly, in Psalms, turn to Psalms 139, verse 16. If you go before, this is why abortion is such a damnable act, and why abortion is murder. Psalms 139, 13. For you have formed my inner parts, my inward parts. You have covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. We didn't evolve. It wasn't just two pieces of blob or protoplasm. God was there in that moment of conception. He breathed the spirit of life into that child in that womb. And if we take that baby from the womb when the mother detects that she is now carrying a child, it's murder, murder, murder. I'm going to call what it is. It's murder. That's not a choice. It's murder. Hitler would have been proud of what's going on in this country. Miss Sanger, Margaret Sanger, is it any wonder that she put abortion clinics in the ghetto areas? You know why she did that? She didn't like black people. She was trying to annihilate the blacks. I ain't making it up. Look it up. I'm telling you the truth. God help us, country. Bring us back to you, God. Give us revival. I will praise you. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret, skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance yet unformed. The Lord sees us before we even form. He knows us. He knows our name. He knows everything about us. He knows how many days, how many weeks, how many months, how many years we're going to have. He's already got it all planned. He's got plans for us. Your eyes saw me. Your eyes saw my substance yet unformed. And in your book, they all were written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet they were none of them. And I'll tell you what, any abortionist that cuts that short, they're going to answer to God for murder and answer to God for what they did to that little baby. Turn to Ecclesiastes now, I'm almost done. I wasn't going to get into all this serious stuff. I was going to get into something a little lighter. Oh well, that's the way it goes. In Ecclesiastes, I want to give you a picture of the aging process. And as I was looking at my devotional this week, I want to read this whole story. How are you today, ma'am? How are you today, mama? As I casually asked my 84-year-old friend, pointing to the aches, the pains in her joints, whispering, old age is tough. And then she added earnestly, but God has been good to me. Growing old has been the greatest surprise of my life, says Billy Graham in his book, Nearing Home. I am an old man now, and believe me, it's not easy. However, Graham notes, while the Bible doesn't gloss over the problems we face as we grow old, Neither does it paint old age as a time to be despised or burdened to be or a burden to be endured with gritted teeth. He then mentions some of the questions he had been forced to deal with as he has aged, such as how can we not only learn to cope with the fears and the struggles of growing limitations we face, but also actually grow stronger inwardly in the midst of these difficulties. Brothers and sisters, as I look here in the Word of God, and the Word of God has so much for us. You know, God gives us three basic principles of life, and if we live by these three basic principles in the Word of God, we'll have a much fuller life. He's got the principle of proper diet, proper exercise, and proper sleep. How many times when I go to the doctor, and I got a physical coming up, I got to pass the Department of Transportation physicals, not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday, and I would appreciate some 8th of March if you all would keep me in prayer, because I've been struggling with some things in my body. My body's telling me to retire, but I'm not quite there yet. And I would like to get another year and a half in. And I don't want to have to go do the physical every year. So pray with me that God will have mercy on me and favor the side of the doctors and everything. Just wait to me out past the physical Tuesday, March 8th. But the most important thing is, the Bible says bodily exercise profit little, but it didn't say any profit at all. But the most important thing is seeking the Lord first, putting Him first. And if we put the Lord first and enact these other three principles of proper exercise, proper diet, and proper sleep, good amount of sleep, you'd be surprised how much healthier you'll be and how much better the aging goes. When you're younger, you can abuse yourself. And for about 30 years, the first 28 years of my life, I abused myself pretty good. But after I got saved and God delivered me from alcohol and drugs, I didn't realize how bad I felt physically, because of allergies and sinus problems and so forth. And then God worked with me on that and got me to a place where I could function and hold a job all these years and so forth and so on. But there's the warning that I don't give up and ask God to give me strength. And He is so gracious. He is. And if I thought it was bad at 28, 29, 30 years old, I had no idea what 30 and 40 was going to bring. Had no idea what 50 was going to bring. And I'll tell you what, 50s are great compared to 60s. I can't hardly wait for 70s and 80s if God allows me. Can I hear an amen? Now, as we're getting ready to look at the aging process in Ecclesiastes 12, I'm going to bring some stuff to light here. If you're 20 years old, that means you've got 2,600 weekends left. If you're 30 years old, that means you've got 2,080 weekends left. If you're 40 years old, you've got 1,560 weekends left. If you're 50 years old, you've got 1,040 weekends left. And if you're 60 years old and above, 520 and declining quick. That's if you live to be 70 years old. Some of us that are near or at 70 or beyond, we're living on borrowed time, baby. We're living on borrowed time.
Yeah, I'll be 76 Sunday.
Huh? You're on borrowed time, Bill. I got news for you. And you said, I know it.
You're young, Bill.
Yes. Here's the thing. Can anything separate us from the love of Christ? Where we're stirred up, does it mean He no longer loves us when we have these troubles? No, it doesn't mean that. And in many cases, it means we're just getting old. I tell you what, it stinks, and it ain't for wimps. But what do people do that don't know Jesus? I remember when eating used to be a pleasure. Now Patty knows what I'm talking about. When you eat, it ain't a pleasure, because sometimes, well, as the rest of the process goes, it's painful. It's a pain, old. That's all I'm going to say. You know, according to the U.S. Census Bureau, there's 150,000 deaths per day. 1.78 deaths per second, 107 per minute, 6,390 per hour. So in the time I preach this message and the time we've had service, 13,000 people have died in the world. In a 24-hour period, 56 million. 24-hour period, 56 million. people will die in a 7-year span. Now that's encouraging, isn't it? Let me give you more words of encouragement. Go to Ecclesiastes 12. Solomon nailed this thing down. Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth. And those statistics you can check out on Wikipedia, by the way. That's the latest in the world census. Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days come. The difficult days, you know what the difficult days are? Some of us are living in the difficult days. Can I hear an amen? Yeah. Man, when I was younger, there's a lot that I could do, you know. I can still do a lot, but the recovery time is a whole lot longer. Can I hear an amen? Instead of being 5 minutes recovery, or 10 minutes, or an hour, or a day, now it's 3, 4, 5, a month. Yeah. Scott and I have chopped some wood together. Felt great while we were doing it. Afraid to stop because we knew what was going to happen once we stopped. Things were going to stow up. It was going to take 2 or 3 days of living and everything else to loosen it back up. That stinks. But thank God we can still do it, Scott. Amen. Before the difficult days come, and the years draw you when you, and the years draw near when you say, I have no pleasure in them. Some of us are living life and we don't like it anymore. It's not that we don't want to live. It's not that we're suicidal. It's just that life's painful when you get older. Am I relating to anybody today? Can I hear an amen? I don't know about you, but I don't like some of the things we go through in today's time. I have no pleasure in them. And while the sun, the light, the moon, the stars are darkened, what's he talking about here? He's talking about the function of the eyes. Remember me telling you I got floaters I'm dealing with trying to see my Bible, study and stuff? Function. I still got my eyes. I can still see. I can still pass a physical. I can still read and so forth. But these things are floating by like clouds float by, you know. What was that? I remember when Woody started this years ago talking about things being blurry and stuff. I thought, man, Woody, I know what you're talking about now. I wish I didn't, but I know. And the clouds do not return after the rain. What are the clouds? It's crying. We got a lot of things to cry about as we get older. And sometimes we cry so much, we can't cry anymore. And it seems like we no more get through one problem, there's another problem coming. Clouds are coming, we cry ourselves to sleep, we cry ourselves awake, we cry ourselves while we're awake. But sometimes we just can't cry anymore because there ain't nothing left to cry about. Come on, there's a lot left to cry about. The water's dried up. Eyes don't want to be lubricated anymore. One sad experience after the next. Takes longer time to recover. Going on. In the day when the keepers of the house tremble. Who are the keepers of the house? The keepers of the house are the legs. Keepers of the house tremble. You ever see some people who are really old, much older than one and me? Their legs tremble. Thank God we're not there yet, woman. Keepers of the house tremble. And a strong man bow down. What are the strong men? The shoulders. The shoulders. And the grinders cease because they are few. What are the grinders? The teeth. I still got, looks like all my teeth, but really, I got a lot of crowns. I ain't talking about the ones you wear on your head, but the ones you wear in your head. They ain't cheap. Never forget when I started fracturing my molars. The dentist kept saying, you got good teeth. I said, Doc, how does that get good teeth? They keep falling apart. He says, no, the root system's good. So let me make this crown for it and we'll glue it on there. They still function, but they ain't like the original equipment. The grinders, they fall out, they're few, they cease, they don't grind anymore. And look, and those that look through the windows grow dim. That's your eyesight, looking through. Looking out of the windows. And the doors of the street are shut. What are the doors of the street? That's your hearing, your ears. You can't hear like you used to, huh? You know, I've had selective hearing for years with my wife. Sometimes I'd be sitting in a room watching a TV show, she's talking to me, and I just don't hear a word that she says because I don't want to. And there's other times I can be in the other room, she's whispering, I heard everything she said. Can I hear an amen? And don't laugh at me because you do it too, and some of you wives do the same thing your husbands. So, I ain't talking about that. And I'm just, what happens is sometimes our hearing just starts to go as we get older. And the sound of grinding is low, and one rises from the sound. When you're young, you hear the sounds of birds chirping. hear music. Even at the low volume, you hear music. But as you get older, it ain't there anymore. And have you ever been afraid to climb a ladder as a young person or climb a tree? No, not as a young person. I remember when we lived down here in Moscow, next to the park, we had a pine tree in the backyard. It was a pretty good sized pine at that time. And I chopped off the bottom limbs to keep the boys from climbing that tree. And AJ decides one day, and I mean, I had those limbs chopped up by so far, and he's just about so high, he gets up on the bike, he climbs on the bike, he gets that limb, he swings up like a monkey, and I'm coming out looking all over him because I couldn't find out where he's at. And I'm hearing somebody whistling and singing. I'm looking all over, where are you at? I'm here, Danny. Where you at? I'm here, Danny. Where? Up here. He's at the top of this pine tree and it's swinging in the breeze. It's like, I said, get down here now. He's all the way at the top of that thing. I mean, he was going to go clean to, couldn't go no more. He's already up there, which was pretty weak. Get on down here. He got on down there and I took the saw and I chopped a few more limbs off. I went through that now. As a matter of fact, when it's time to put these lights in, I used to climb up, put the lights in, and help that. I'll hold the ladder now. I'll let a young man climb up. And I'll explain why in a little bit. That's why we get more afraid of heights. We're afraid of heights. Why? Because we're afraid of falling. Why? It's not so much that the fall's painful. It's the recovery time from the fall. What if you break an arm? If you break a hip, you break this. When you're younger, everything heals up a lot faster. You break an arm or hip, but as an older person, it ain't no fun. My mom, 87 years old, broke her hip. They pinned it and screwed it in three places. My brother's got his hip pinned and screwed. My mom's got her hip pinned and screwed. Of course, my brother, 45 years old, from an RV accident, you know, one of those ATV accidents. My mom, this old age, she slipped and fell. My son's got his back pinned and screwed from the blow out of the T9 disc. So the T9 and T10 vertebrae are fused together and screwed together. You might say I got a screwed up family. I knew that for years, but now we've really got a screwed up family. Can I hear an amen? Got another son who lost half his finger. His finger, part of his finger was half before him. Finger would be in a weight on you. So we're afraid of heights because we're afraid of falling. And the terror, by the way, what's the terror, by the way? It's the sounds in the street, dangers in the street. And the almond tree blossoms. What's an almond tree? That's when you're gray. That's when your colored hair turns gray. And when it goes from gray to white. Gray hair is supposed to be a sign of, you know, wisdom and so forth, the church and so forth. White hair, I don't know if that's a sign. White is going to gray soon, I guess. Almond tree, white. Grasshopper burdens. You drag yourself along. I was telling my wife the other day, I just don't have any energy anymore. I don't know. One day I came home a couple weeks ago and was wanting to deal with me about getting back to exercise. That's the last thing I like to do is exercise. For about 2-3 weeks, I'd get out of the car and say, God, I feel like I'm dying. I feel like I'm dying. The Lord kept pushing me, exercise. You know, a lot of my shoulder problems that I was having, all my joint problems I was having. Lack of exercise! Lack of exercise. I'm speaking for me now, not for you. So I started on a treadmill a couple weeks ago. Boy, I didn't realize how out of shape I was. I used to be able to run so far and walk so far. I started out ground zero again. And lifting weights. I put the weights on I usually lift. I went and lifted them. What happened? I looked at him again. Yeah, run out. I start over. I start over at the beginning of my program and work my way back up. It's taken me almost 3 weeks to get back up where I was a year ago and I stopped working out. But I hurt my knee. The aging process stinks. But if you feel these muscles, there it is, baby, right there. You'll feel bald. I can move. I mean, I guess if you ain't moving, it's easier to hit a target when it's not moving, I guess. Grasshopper burden. You just drag yourself along. It also means you have no energy. It also means that maybe your romantic life ain't what it used to be. I ain't speaking from experience there. Leave that go. And a man goes from his eternal home, after all this, if your eyes function not working anymore, after your legs aren't working like it's supposed to be, after your shoulders are sloped over, after your teeth have fallen out, after your eyes are dim, if your ears... If you're not, if you're afraid of heights, if you're afraid of going out anywhere because you might get jumped or whatever. Now we're going to talk about the organs of the body. We're going to talk about the organs of the body. The silver cord is loose. That's your spinal cord, or it could be the spirit in you. And the bowl is broken. What's the golden bowl? It's the noggin. It's the head that protects the brain. It's the head and the skull that protects the computer. The computerized the whole body of the brain. And the pitcher is shattered at the fountain. That's your lungs working in conjunction with your cardiovascular system. And the wheel is broken at the well. That's the heart, the pump. A little couple pound thing here that pumps how many times a minute. If it don't pump, you're done. And see, one thing we learned when AJ was in the hospital years ago. If the breathing and the if the breathing isn't right, if the function isn't right of the lungs, and you're not getting enough oxygen, it affects your heart, it affects your blood flow, it affects the oxygen in the blood. If there's not enough oxygen, your blood starts getting thick, and the heart can't pump it, and then you get an embolism, blood clot, you could die. It all works together, and this is in the Word of God. God knows what He's talking about. The silver cord, or the spirit in you, or your spinal cord. The golden bowl is the head that's protecting your brain. The brain that tells everything what to do in the body. And the phone system, the spinal cord, that sends it to all different parts of your body. And the lungs function, and the heart functions. If it's not functioning right, what happens to a part of the body when blood stops flowing there? Gangrene sets in. Gangrene is rotting flesh. And what happens is, if the oxygen's not going there, if the blood's not going through there, if the good stuff's not going in, the bad stuff's not being taken out, we inhale, the good stuff comes in, we exhale, the bad stuff goes out. If that isn't functioning properly, the next thing is the dust will turn to earth. We'll all turn to dust, we'll die, we'll turn to dust, and the Spirit will turn to God who gave it. The preacher says, vanity, vanity. Everything's vanity. Let me tell you something. If you don't know God, life is vain. If you don't know God, life is fleeting. If you don't know God, life makes no sense at all. But brothers and sisters, He's shown us the aging process here. And the reason why I bring this up is because when you're not feeling well, don't sit around and think God doesn't love you anymore. God loves you as much now as the first day you said, I do to God. God loves you as much as the first day when you came to the Lord and asked Him in your heart. He loves you as much now as when you were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Life is tough. Moreover, because the preacher was wise and he still taught the people knowledge, yes, he pondered and sought out and set in order many proverbs. The preacher sought to find acceptable words. I try to find this every day, the right words to say when I preach. What was written, what was upright, words of truth. The words of the wise are like goads, and the words of the scholars are like well-driven nails, given by one shepherd, Jesus Christ. And further, my son, my daughter, be admonished by these things. Making of many books, there is no end. And much study is wearisome to the flesh. Thus, here's the conclusion of the whole matter. Here's the conclusion of the whole matter. As you age, the aging process, remember this. Number one, fear God, keep His commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every work into judgment, every secret thing, including every secret thing, whether it is good or whether it is evil. Stand with you. Aging and getting old